Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. There is no book of the Bible more commented on and referred to by Jesus in the Gospels than the book of Psalms. It is widely renowned as one of the most powerful books of the Bible, simply because the Psalms, as used by the Holy Spirit, is so useful for changing a person's attitude, lifting them from the doldrums of whatever horizontal position they're in, and bringing their hearts to the very tabernacle, the very firmament of heaven. We will see the psalmist use that term in verse 1, to bring your heart into the very tabernacle of the living God. Now, I love that. I have a vivid imagination, and the book of Revelation does so much in chapters 4 and 5 to just kind of enliven that, you know. To me, I just love the book of Revelation for just exciting my heart in the expectation of what it will be like to worship Him in the firmament of heaven. And you know, I think it's a little bit humorous, at least, when those that really know very little of Scripture or of the God of Scripture speak in terms of us all turning into angels. I will never be an angel. Amen. Hallelujah. I will never be a fat little baby playing a harp in heaven. And neither shall you. What the Lord declares concerning us is that which is also declared here in Psalm 150. Our existence is established on the praise of the living God. There is no grander or higher purpose for man than to praise the living God. And certainly, even a cursory study of the book of Psalms would lead you truly to praise Him, even if you just read the verses of this amazing book. You would read in terms of giving praise to Him. And how could anyone read Psalm 150 without being enticed, as it were, encouraged to praise Him, as of course it prescribes we should. So once again, Psalm 150, beginning and ending with that amazing, wonderful Hebrew singular word, hallelujah. Praise Jehovah, praise the Lord, praise the Almighty God of all creation, praise the Lord. And it concludes with that as well. And shouldn't anything in life, shouldn't every day, every evening, every night, every waking moment be preceded and succeeded by the comment of praise the Lord? You know, to give thanks to God, to praise Him for who He is really bent out of an attitude that has been changed by the God who you are praising. Our God has moved us from our BC lives to a life contemplating constantly the glory of our God, or it should be. I have had wonderful worshipful events where I have been in truly raptured by either listening or participating. I mean, even in listening to a symphony, somehow I feel my heart is participating in that which I'm hearing. And you know, the wonderful thing about worship music is that the more you become a worshiper, the quicker, it seems to me, my heart jumps into worship when worship begins. And really jumps at the opportunity to worship as the Lord dictates, as the Holy Spirit moves me. And it's not because I have great musical ability. You probably know that that's genuinely not true. But the praise of God does something in the heart of man in bringing, drawing, including them in the sanctuary of God, in the presence of His holy creatures. Worship changes men's hearts. It really does. Praise changes men's hearts. And the most selfish, conceited, discontent person, if they begin to worship, if they begin to thank God, their hearts are changed. Their attitude is changed. Their spirit is changed. And they begin to see God in terms of His providence rather than His stinginess, perhaps. And you know what? We can, as Christians, at times think God is stingy. But praise brings us back to recognize, oh, what a rich provider our God is. Is He not? Is He not? Praise Him for His mighty acts. Has God ever done something mighty as an act in your life? You need to praise Him for it. If He hasn't, you need to wake up and start getting into the Word of God. Okay, start getting out of the house a little bit, all right? God does mighty acts in such magnificent ways that it's hindsight's 20/20. You can look back at times when it seems as though God was withholding His favor in a certain event or a certain issue or need, and now looking back on that, I see that God was doing things in other arenas to bring about a greater good among many people rather than just for my specific benefit. And how He orchestrated these things truly was something that only God could do, you know, only God could do. So I praise Him for His mighty acts. And whether, you know, it be something miraculous where, you know, in a very instantaneous manner He has provided something for you that you know that you are absolutely sure God could have only done. That's a mighty act. But nonetheless, God does mighty acts. Even today, when you think in the doldrums of common life that, you know, here you are this evening and nothing that exciting has gone on. And yet behind the scenes, across the veil of life, you know not how God has stayed the hands of so many disastrous events and the grand desire of the demonic world to sift you like wheat, to harm, to hurt, to bring glory to the devil rather than to the Lord. And I know not whether we will be able to visit those unseen events when we are with God, but I praise Him for His mighty acts, whether I even saw something that I would consider to be mighty this day. Our nation's a nation that has seen great and mighty acts occur in it only because of the hand of God. My family is a family that recognizes that God has done some mighty things, mighty acts in our lives, and recognizing in those things that only God could have done them, whether they be something that you might consider to be, well, that's such commonplace, that's hardly worthy of calling it a mighty act. Oh, well, it is. It's a mighty act to me. And it would be a mighty act to anyone else who is used to praising Him in His sanctuary, used to and looking forward to praising Him in the firmament of heaven. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Greatness of God is excellent. The greatness of God is excellent. God is excellency. He doesn't achieve that. He's not one day going to be more excellent. We're not hoping that when I get to heaven, then God can really, you know, He can relax a little bit, you know. He can kind of, you know, He's free to do a little bit more with other people because He's not having to spend so much time with me. God is excellent. He is the embodiment of excellence. He is the embodiment of greatness. Well, if you were to look up in the Heavenly Dictionary, the word greatness and excellency, you would see God. You would see the incarnation of Jesus himself. He is greatness. He is excellency. And we praise him because this excellent greatness has become our excellent greatness. We are fellow heirs with Christ. And the inheritance of our Savior is one that is being held until we, with him, will enjoy it for eternity. And that excellent greatness we will share with him. We will occupy his throne with him. Excellent greatness. Wow. I think in terms of what's excellent to me now. I don't use that word often. I don't know, maybe you do. When you think of something or you just had a great chicken pot pie and you'd say, excellent, you know? You'd say, excellent, right? Who had a great chicken pot pie tonight? Well, there was one at the potluck tonight. You missed it. Excellent. You just well, that's excellent. That's just, yeah, it's excellent, you know? But keep in mind, the terms by which we use those things now, I think will be entirely redefined once we are with the Lord. Would you not suspect? What we would consider to be excellent now will be absolutely excellent when we get with the Lord. Eyes not seen, ears not heard, neither is it even entered into the heart of man, those things that the Lord has saved up for those that love him. Do you love him? That he has excellence waiting for you. And excellent greatness waiting for you. Things that you could not fathom to see here. Things you could not fathom to hear. Things you could not fathom to touch. Could not fathom to smell. Could not fathom to taste. Could not fathom to have a sense of its reverberation in your presence. And you know, it's coming. It's coming soon. And this is what the Lord has saved up for those that love him. So we praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Now the trumpet, of course, in the days of the psalmist was the shofar. And to blow the shofar is in fact, I think, a skill, to be honest with you. The shofar that I once had and gave to a friend of mine had a very small mouthpiece. And unless you're a trumpet player, but be able to get something going on there was really a skill, really, really a skill. And of course, to blow the trumpet is to blow, it's to acknowledge the presence of God. It's to call believers in worship. And of course, trumpet blowing occurred commonly, daily at the temple. And there were, of course, feasts of trumpets, and Rosh Hashanah is, it leads to Yom Kippur, which leads to the Feast of Tabernacles. And these feasts are all enunciated by the blowing of trumpets in very specific order with staccato and long tones, and all for the purpose of people knowing by their Hebraic teaching this is what God is calling for at this very moment. And as far as you could hear the trumpet all around Jerusalem, you would know that you would be... This is the prescription right at this point, is to stop and to confess, to stop and give praise, to stop and glory in the Lord. These trumpet calls were the things that called people, like you would think, you know, here comes the Calvary. Da, 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 da. Well, that's what God would use these for. And I believe they will be used in the time of eternity in heaven as well. I think trumpet calls will call us to worship, will call us wherever we are in the universe to a moment of stopping and reaching in our spirit into the mighty firmament of heaven, into the tabernacle of God, and singing with the angels concerning his greatness. And I look forward to that. Praise him with the lute and the harp. Praise him with the timbrel and the dance. A timbrel would be kind of like a tambourine kind of thing, right? And to dance, and this is why I've said this evening, my heart is, I look forward to the day when I can dance with Jesus. Now, we have an office meeting, staff meeting, we had one today because there were a lot of things going on yesterday. I had a board meeting in Santa Barbara. And so we talked about the subject that I had attached to the sermon tonight, putting Jesus on your dance card, and I was astonished to discover that the far majority of my staff have no idea what a dance card is. That's astonishing to me, because that only means I'm way older than they is, right? But you know, there used to be a time when you would attend very well-organized dances that weren't absolute pandemonious mayhem, okay, where people ran into each other and beat each other up and things like this. I mean, these were dances that you're expected to dance, dances that you had been taught actually in school. And in the town that I was raised in, my parents sent me to something that you probably never even heard the word, cotillion. Anybody ever heard that word before? Cotillion? Yeah, that's astonishing to me. A few of you have. And that's where young men and women went to learn to be polite. This is where you learned table manners and how to introduce yourself in a reception line, how you would be gentlemanly to a young girl that you were asking to dance with you, and how you would not only approach, but you would, the reception from her would be as, you know, equally as careful and very guarded, and you would be very careful about how you spoke to her, how you danced with her, and girls always dance with gloves because you were not supposed to touch another person's skin, and very guarded steps with very unique songs, and I went to that, and I learned a lot about that. And it's in those places that if you're familiar with cotillion or dance cards, that you would, the girls would carry a bid, is what it was called, and this is a place where they would write down who they danced with, and this was of course for the purpose of reporting to their parents who they were with that evening. And their parents would look at the bid and they'd see that my daughter was with these certain men and these young boys, and there would be discussion concerning that, and it was very proper, very correct, and it was just a good thing. But I'm here to say to you, those days are long gone, aren't they? They are very long gone. You think it's a success just for your daughter to come home from a high school dance without being pregnant. I mean, you know, that kind of a thing these days, I would suspect. I don't know. I can't imagine sending a child to a dance these days. But I want to dance with Jesus. And here Scripture is saying, let's dance. That's exactly what it's saying. It's saying, let's get out the tambourines. Let's get out the trumpets. Let's get out the band. Let's get out the instruments of bringing glory to God in praise, and let's dance. Let's dance. And I so want to do that. I really do. I look forward to dancing in heaven. I really do. I would love to be free enough to be able to dance with you here. I really would. But the days have changed. Things have become so precarious these days that it's difficult to think in terms of people's minds being proper and with respect and honor, with a degree of not only the approach but the recession, in the sense of what that means in being together. And I'm sorry to say that I think really those days are gone. I really do. I was with a bunch of other pastors the other day, and we were just talking about the changes that have happened in church, and how, as far as we knew, every church that we were familiar with no longer had a singles group, simply because singles groups just are not done in church anymore. It's too precarious. It's too difficult. It's a problematic issue that only presents difficulties rather than what should be proper opportunities for people to meet each other. No churches do it anymore. And you know, that's just, there's a degree of sadness in my heart regarding that, but a great degree of relief as well, because I can't fathom having one here. I really can't. It just means trouble with a capital T. You know, it really does. But how glorious to think that when the corruptible is gone, when the perishable has been taken away, and the holiness is set in with an eternal set. We cannot be changed again, and only holiness will flow. Only purity and chastity will be ours. And you might think, well, how boring can you get? Oh my, no. You have no idea. You really have no idea if that's what you think. Because I think the greatest joys are yet to be discovered in heaven. Really are. Really are. There's a degree to intimacy that I think few men and women really ever understand. Even married couples really ever understand. An intimacy that's only really born through the Holy Spirit and through the Word of God. It has nothing to do with sex. It has nothing to do with flesh stuff. It has everything to do with the Spirit of God. An intimacy that is eternal. So we praise Him not just with cymbals, but we praise Him with loud cymbals. Ever feel like that cymbal was too loud? I'm in worship and that cymbal was too loud. Oh, really? Wait till you hear the cymbals in heaven. Oh, man, did you hear that cymbal? Calm down, James, you know? Well, what about a clashing cymbal? Wow. So now we have not only loud cymbals, but we have cymbals that are clashing in the sense that there's almost a war between those two cymbals going on, you know? Ever been to a symphony where this guy with perfect tempo in the exact timing of the orchestration brings those clashing cymbals together? And you know, that guy's a professional clasher. He really is. Boy, he knows how to clash, you know? He just got it right down, you know? And you could spend your whole life never figuring out how to clash like that, but he's got it down. And that's going to be the way it is in heaven. And this is why we can conclude in verse 6 by saying, let everything that has breath, praise the Lord. You have breath tonight? You need to praise the Lord. You know what? You can have breath tomorrow. I pray that you do. And if so, that you will praise the Lord. You will begin the day with praising God. You will close the day with praising God. Every moment during the day, you will give thanks to Him. Because when you give thanks, you know, malcontent flees. It really does. The confidence of a mighty God, a glorious God, a God of mighty acts, a God that knows you intimately, the confidence of that is one which leads us to praising Him tonight, is it not? So we have looked at 150 psalms over the course of almost 4 years. And we've discovered in the course of these psalms that the psalmists have shared something quite intimate with them, for each of these psalms were intended to be sung, not just read, not some poetic just nonsense of sorts, but really intended to be read, intended to be meditated upon, intended to be sung together. These psalmists have shared their hearts with us concerning God. And as we've concluded this night, we're saying that, Lord, we're going to take these psalms from this point on. We're going to take the breath that is in our lungs. We're going to take the lips that are on our face. With the power of our tongues, we're going to praise the Lord all the rest of our days. Amen. Let's stand as we close tonight. Father, glorious, mighty God who exists in all things, Lord Jesus, you have seen fit to lead us through these psalms, to teach us to praise, to teach us to worship, to teach us, Father, to take our eyes off us and put them on you, Lord God. You are the magnificent God of excellent greatness, whose mighty acts would take volumes the earth could not contain to record, Father. In each of our lives, Lord God, we can in an instant describe the miraculous, mighty acts that you have done that have led us this evening to give you praise, that have led us in just the history of our faithfulness to come back again to church this evening and to once again stand in praise with other saints and to listen as the Spirit of God leads us in the Word of God to follow the prescription of God to praise you, Almighty Jesus. And so we do that this evening. And we leave not the life of praise by leaving the book of Psalms. Rather, Lord God, now that we've been educated in such a manner, might we be people of even greater praise, more common praise. Might we be people, Lord God, that would consider that, Jesus, you are worth praising every moment of the day. And thank you that you give us the hearts to do that, to praise you, to thank you, to glorify you. O God of excellent greatness, we worship you this evening. And thank you for the power of this book, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in his spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, senior pastor of Calvary Chapel.